attention, that's for sure.
Good morning to you all.
Good morning.
And happy Father's Day, guys.
Happy Father's Day to all four of us.
But you know what? We're in church on Sunday morning, so we can be celebrating the ultimate Father's Day, which is our Heavenly Father. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, Father's Day is kind of interesting because when we did the Mother's Day stuff, you know, we made a point of talking about the fact that mothers come in all shapes and sizes, and some women are mothers even though they don't actually have their own kids. Well, the same is true of men. So we want to celebrate all the fathers of all shapes and sizes. So we have a little video to that effect. Let's do that.
Today is a special day, and it's bigger than you think. Because there are many different kinds of fathers, and they all need to be recognized and honored today. Today we honor those fathers who consistently strive to balance loving their wives and children with being good, godly workers at their jobs. May you feel the pleasure of God. Today we honor those dads who have poor fathers themselves, but who have committed never to become the father they grew up under. May your children continue to be guarded from any of the hurt you carry. Today we honor the fathers who are older and who no longer have day-to-day obligations to their own children. May the family gatherings this weekend make you feel like you can do it all over again. Today we honor the adult children of fathers who are absent. May the God of the fatherless become your father in ways you've only dreamed of. And may you believe with your whole heart that his leaving wasn't your fault. Today we honor men who have no children of their own, but who father younger men as mentors and guides. May you see your important roles as impacting and life-changing. And finally today we honor fathers who have passed away. May their good deeds live on through you, and may their careless deeds be corrected in your lifetime. Today is a special day. So for all the fathers we mentioned, and even those we didn't, be honored, be blessed, and be joyful. We believe that you have what it takes to change the world, and you're doing it one relationship at a time. Happy Father's Day.
Continue with our worship service of our Heavenly Father with the call to worship as is listed in your program, and it goes like this. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not of your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Ephesians 2, verses 8 through 10. And now we have some announcements, I believe. And while Victor comes up, I'm going to change this game. Hey, a candle in the box.
Good morning, welcome, and happy Father's Day again to the fathers. And here's the announcement. After service fellowship, remember we enjoy refreshments four times out of the month. The first Sunday we do food, and we're doing food today, and we want to thank Jeff and Debbie and Jeff, and please join us over for a meal. And if you'd like to sign up for 1 week, that's coming up, please see June, or there's a calendar up there. That's too loud, right? Sorry. Okay, here's some exciting news. Joint service. On Sunday, August 21st, we will have a joint service with Palos Verdes Baptist Church. Now, service will be at 10 a.m. to accommodate both congregations. So, we don't have to get here at the time we normally do. We'll get here at 10, and the other church will get here at 10 to instead of what they get here. So please join us. It's going to be awesome. Every time we have our joint service, it turns out really nice. And then we should have a fellowship time afterwards. Beacon Light Mission is this Wednesday, June 21st. Let's get a few more people to show our love for the homeless. And please try to join us and show Pastor our support. Now, here's on the pastor search. We've had several people inquiring about what's happening. We've been in contact with Andy Quinn, who is our executive minister for Absco Flash. And here are the plans as it goes so far. When pastor retires, we will have an interim pastor come in, and they normally are about 18 months is what it takes to do a pastor search. So we're not going to be in any kind of a hurry to say, I want to get the pastor tomorrow. We want to make sure we get the right person in here. Like we had the pastor for 9 years, and it was a good fit. Now it's time for him to retire, and so we're going to pray and get somebody else that's the right fit here. And then there's been a couple other leads that we're following up on, so hopefully we'll have something more. And in a few weeks, if I have more information, I will share it with you guys, okay? But if you start wondering what's going on, ask myself, pastor, or one of the other elders, all right? And that's all the announcements I have.
All right, there we go. It is God's wisdom to call the pastor, not the churches. So what we have to do is trust in the Lord, and what will happen will happen. Amen?
Amen.
And so the most important thing we can do about that, by the way, is pray. So let's take out your prayer card. Praises and prayers. We are very blessed that for 9 years, we've had our ups and our downs, but we're still going strong. And even considering the lower numbers, our financial picture is good. So I think we're well positioned for whoever comes in September. Just as a note on the retirement thing, the September 1st is a Friday, so August 28th is the Sunday before that. August 28th would be my last Sunday in the pulpit. And then those few days, then the following week, I'll be packing up my swords. It's probably going to take me a week to do that. So that's kind of the thing. That's why we picked the 21st as a joint service. Pastor Nick actually initiated the idea, and I told him it would be a great... How many of you have been here when we've done a joint service? A few. It's a lot of fun because it's something a little different. And as Victor said, we kind of fudged the time both directions because we figured if we told you guys you got to be here at 9, some of you might not make it. And if we told the other church, well, you have to be here at 11, some of them wouldn't make it. So we've done this twice in the 9 years, and 10 o'clock seems to work for everybody, and we'll have a good time, and we'll be putting together what I think will be a good time. So Pastor Nick and I will share pulpit that day. So things are happening. God is moving along. But what we need to do is pray on the things that are really important. So what we always start with?
Praises.
So let's take a moment together and write down some things that you want to praise the Lord for. And let's do that together right now. you haven't already done so, let's go to the other side and look at our prayer requests. This is where we raise up our voices as a body to the Lord and lay before Him those things which are on our heart. And as I said before, I'm hoping that a prayer for God's guidance on the new pastor will be on everybody's mind, if not on their heart. So let's take some time right now and write down our prayer requests. Once again, we come to the time where we share the Lord's Prayer. And I hope you never forget going forward over the years when you say the Lord's Prayer, the admonition I share with you every week, that you could really listen to what it is that you are praying. Because whenever you say amen, what you are saying is, what I just prayed, Lord, may it be so. So let's share together as we do. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen. Now let's worship the Lord in song. Kelly?
Good morning. Let's stand, please, together, and let's sing out our praises to the Lord with This Is My Father's World. worship songs with Faith of Our Fathers as we continue with our theme of Father's Day.
Thank you.
Now, if you notice in the past few weeks as we go through the book of Acts, they're dealing with this issue of you have the Jewish Christians over here and the Gentile Christians over here, and there's been a little bit of headbutting. There's some definite ideas about what it really means to be a Christian, and there's been some conflict around that. So over the last couple of chapters specifically, we've seen that issue being dealt with in a variety of different ways. Peter goes up, preaches to the Gentiles, they receive the Holy Spirit. Paul and Barnabas go and deal with the Gentiles, and they are blessed. And then people come along and they're saying, well, wait a minute, they've got to do more stuff than just profess Christ. So we're going to delve into that today, because salvation is through the grace of Jesus Christ. Let me just say that again, and we can go have lunch. Really, look at the title of the sermon. It's just the gospel. That's it. Salvation is through the grace of Jesus Christ. A couple of presidential cycles a while back, remember one of our presidents said his whole campaign was, it's the economy, stupid. Well, I'm not going to use that exactly, but salvation through the grace of Jesus Christ. Some people still insist, though, on adding to the plan. They believe things such as, not only should you accept Jesus, but you need to be baptized, or you need to be confirmed, or you need to take the Lord's Supper. Now, a quick read of the New Testament, the early writers should have settled all this stuff forever. There is no question. Salvation is through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if you have your Bibles, turn to chapter 15 of Acts. We're picking up the story at verses 22. And we're going to look at 3 points to cover this passage. But first, what should we do?
Pray.
Thank you. I was going to stand there listening to say pray. When you go to your text, even in your private prayer life, I would encourage you to pray before you go to the Word. Heavenly Father, you send us this message down through time for a reason. You teach us, you uplift us, and you guide us. So, Lord, as we read your words written by the hand of the apostles, may we be blessed, may we be instructed, and may we be guided. We ask this blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so first point number one. The apostles taught from an attitude of humility. In our first block of text, it says that then it seemed good. Then, this is after the Jerusalem Council met. Then it seemed good to the apostles and the elders with the whole church to choose men from among them and send them up to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. They also sent Judas, called Barsabbas, and Silas, leading men among the brothers, with the following letter. The brothers, this is them writing to the people in Antioch. The brothers, both the apostles and the elders, to the brothers who are of the Gentiles in Antioch and Syria and Sicilia, greetings. So stop right there. What's significant about that? Brothers, 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 brothers. So you have the Christians in Jerusalem, the Jerusalem Council, they open up the letter with this refrain of, we're writing brother to brother to brother. They place themselves on an equal level by calling the Gentiles brothers. They never acted as if they were any higher up the ladder than they were. They declared the decision was a decision of all the brothers. They're writing brother to brother, placing themselves on the same level. That's the lesson for today. We are equal in the eyes of God. Now, sure, there has to be some sort of an authority to keep things organized and running well. Imagine our church without Victor. So you have to have some leadership, or things just don't happen. But just because someone has a position of leadership, it doesn't mean they are more important or any closer to God. These leaders, including the apostles themselves, realized that they were humble recipients of salvation, just as all other men. They were all brothers in the Lord. We are all brothers and sisters in the Lord. That means that all were saved alike through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is a fundamental principle. There are no higher level Christians than other Christians. There are no more holy than others. There may be some better behaved than others. But in the eyes of God, which is really the only determinant that we should ever care about, in the eyes of God, you're either saved or you're not saved. You're either in or you're out. God has either taken care of your sin problem or you still have it. So you are saved by grace. Grace is unmerited favor. Grace means that you're getting something you don't deserve. You see, we all have a sin problem, and we all deserve eternal punishment. However, those who have accepted Jesus Christ, their sin problem has been handled. So we are out from under that curse. So the first point is they come to them in humility. Now the second thing is they're trying to be absolutely clear. It's a very clear statement. Ritual and law are not necessary to salvation. The people that are promoting that are even rebuked. Look at the last sentence, verse there. Since we have heard that some persons have gone out from us and troubled you with words, unsettling your minds, although we gave them no instructions. So these Gentile Christians, they're babies in the faith, and they're getting mixed signals. Oh, you need to do this. You need to do that. I've told this story a couple times over 9 years, so maybe you remember, you don't remember. I had worked with an elder gentleman, name was Ed Beaumont. And after working with him for 6 months, right about the time, by the way, when I was about ready to give up, he accepted the Lord, and he was going to church every day, using his walker to stand up so he could worship along with everybody else. And I'm teaching a Sunday school class one morning, and this man came up to me and he says, "I think Ed Beaumont's going to hell." Now imagine my shock, because I knew the man pretty well. And I knew that he had wholeheartedly embraced Jesus Christ. Yeah, he's going to go to hell. What are you talking about? He goes, "Well, he's coming to church every day, but I talk to him, and he's not out telling people about Jesus. He's not evangelizing anybody. He's not trying to spread the gospel." And he said, "You're telling me he's accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. He's acknowledged that Jesus is the Son of God. He's confessed his sins before God. But because he's not going out and doing what you think he ought to do, he's going to hell?" And the guy said, stunningly, the guy said, "Yeah." I will not tell you what I told that man. You are saved by grace through faith, not by works. So let me clarify something. Works are important. If you get over into, we're doing a Bible study on James and on Friday mornings at Beacon Light, we got into the whole thing where James says, "Show me your faith without works." And he makes a big deal about works. But James is not contradicting Paul. What he's just saying is, real faith manifests itself in works. Faith comes first, followed by works. James is just pointing out, if you say you believe in Jesus and you say you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and there's no difference in your life, there's no movement, there's no sign of faith in your life, then the question goes back to, did you actually understand what you were doing? See, I knew that Ed Beaumont knew what he was doing because I debriefed him before I believed him. But see, my point is this. Works are important, and you are supposed to do certain things. But that has nothing to do with your salvation. Your works are a result of salvation. We should work and do everything we can to the glory of God. We should do things. We should come to church. We should do all that stuff. Listen to me. Out of gratitude for what has already been done for us. Not in order to get something done for us. And it's important that we get a grip on that, because you can be led astray. There are groups out there that... I've told you before, I have lots of Mormon friends, and in their system, they will tell you that they believe in Jesus Christ, they believe he is the Son of God, they believe that they cannot go to heaven without the saving grace of Jesus Christ. So we think, well, sounds pretty Christian to me. But you have to read their stuff. What they mean is, that takes care of original sin, and all of your sins are on you. So now you also have to do works. You also have to tithe 10%. You also have to get married in the temple. You also have to, they have a long list, trust me. You have to do all of these things. They even have multiple levels of heaven. And you end up in a different level of heaven depending on your work. So you have to understand that it's just grace. It's just the gospel. That's it. So what Paul and Barnabas and Judas and Silas, what they're dealing with is a misunderstanding. And I'm trying to be generous. These Jewish Christians are coming out of the centuries of adherence to the law. So they're trying to impose upon these new Christians some of the Mosaic law stuff. Let's give them credit that they're just trying to be sincere. But basically what they're saying is, I know what the gospel says, but you also have to do this other stuff. And what the disciples and the apostles at the Jerusalem Council are trying to do is to clear this up, because they don't want to chase people away. They don't want people to think that you've got to do this, and you've got to do this, and you've got to do this. When I came to the Lord, the church I went to, they had a whole process to go through before you got baptized. You had to go to a class, and you had to get on the calendar, because they only did baptisms, you know, like every quarter. I don't remember what it was. So I don't remember what happened, but I missed the class for some reason, and therefore I missed this next schedule. Basically, there were 6 months after I accepted the Lord before I got baptized. And that always kind of worried me until I studied a little bit more. And I'm absolutely convinced if I had gotten hit by a bus sometime in that 6 months, I would have been in heaven. Because the Bible is very clear that you are saved by grace, not through works. Now, did I need to get baptized? Of course. Why? Because the Bible says so. In fact, what Peter says to the question about what must I do to be saved, he says, repent and be baptized. But you notice, in the context of that passage, repent means accepting Christ. So repent and accept Christ, and then get baptized. So that's kind of where that fits. And every denomination, you know, they have different, you know, requirements and different things that they say, well, you've got to do this. But when you really boil it down, you are saved by grace through faith, not by works. And that's what they're trying to communicate to these fellows up in Antioch. Those who are teaching otherwise, these false teachers, are basically getting called out. They trouble the believers with their words. We've always got to remember that mere words spoken by someone who thinks she has authority are just words, unless they line up with Scripture. The reason you need to study Scripture is so that you can recognize a false teacher when it comes along, because they can always sound like they know what they're talking about. The Apostle Paul, he puts it clearly, he boils it down. Look at Ephesians. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. That is the fundamental statement of saved by grace. Salvation is by grace alone. Nothing's to be added to it. Those who stirred up all this stuff in Antioch were not authorized by the church to do that. They were believers, but they tried to add to the plan of salvation to include circumcision. It wasn't true, and they were not authorized to even say it. So the first point is the apostles are doing this. They're teaching this from an attitude of humility. The second point is there's a very clear statement. I don't know how you could make it any clearer than that. And the third point, these were men chosen to proclaim the truth. In our next section here it says, it was seemed good to us, this is the Jerusalem Council talking, having come to one accord to choose men and send them to you with our beloved Barnabas and Saul, men who have risked their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have therefore sent Judas and Silas, who themselves will tell you the same things by word of mouth. So we have a team here. We have Paul and Barnabas and Judas and Silas, all people that have a reputation. And what they're doing is they're, rather than just sending the letter, they're sending credible people with the letter. So watch this. God is sending credible people with the Word of God to share with other people. So you can't just give somebody a Bible and say, go and be blessed. You have to share the gospel with them. Reputable people were sent to deliver the message. Yes, they had a letter, and yes, the letter would get read in the congregation, But you're going to see that it wasn't just enough for them to show up, read the letter, and say, okay, you guys are good to go now and leave. That's not what happened. The church, they sent these four folks. They were the best ministers to send. They were chosen to confirm what they told the new believers in Antioch in the first go-around. This decree of salvation was so important that the written message wasn't enough. It needed proponents who knew the truth of salvation. It needed to be proclaimed by word of mouth. It's not enough to send somebody a nice greeting card with a Bible verse in it. You need to share the gospel with people. And point number four here, there are a few rules that are necessary. For it has seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay on you no greater burden than these requirements. Now remember when the Jerusalem Council met, James stood up and said, this is my conclusion. So basically he's sharing with them that you abstain from what has been sacrificed to idols and from blood and from what has been strangled and from sexual immorality. If you keep yourselves from these, you will do well. Farewell. You will do well. Notice he doesn't say, if you do these things, you will be saved. What he's doing is giving them some basic direction for the Christian life. And these things might seem like an odd collection of things, but remember that the apostles have been through prior, and they've preached the gospel. They've also preached on how to live a godly life. Paul will write extensively on these subjects as going forward. So what he's doing is he's saying, now, if you do these things, things will go well for you. By the way, the book of Proverbs is, they're called wisdom literature, and they're full of things that you ought to pay attention to, but they are not guarantees and promises. It just seems that if you follow wise advice, you will do well. So here they're giving them some wise advice. There's a place in Proverbs where it talks about if you raise up a child in the way they will go, when they are old, they will not depart from it. And then we have Christians that go, but my kid went crazy and left the church and, you know, went into all kinds of strange stuff. So that must not be true. Well, it is true. It's wisdom literature. The advice of that particular proverb is your job is to raise the child the way they should go. Now, that child has a responsibility on what they do with that information. So Proverbs is wisdom literature, and like they're saying here, these are not, if you do these things, you will be saved. You understand? What they're saying is, here's some things that as Christians, you ought to pay attention to, and you'll do well. And that's the kind of guidance and direction we need to give people. Not, you have to obey this rule, and that rule, and there you go. And sometimes we go too far. Sometimes there are rules that we don't understand, but we follow them to the best of our ability. There are times, there are churches, if you were to show up here in dirty jeans and sandals, people would look down on you, would ask you to leave. I remember years ago when we started putting up the signs to have people ride their horse to church, I told some lady, stop by, and she was talking. Actually, she was looking at our hitching post that we put up out there. And she says, well, I'd come to church, but see, I'm in my riding gear, and my boots are dirty and all that. I said, I don't care. Come on. About 2 weeks later, she showed up in her riding gear and her dirty boots. And she came in, and she sat in the back. But the beautiful thing was that, you know, when the time came, everybody kind of went over and talked to her and had so much fun with her. When we did the Juneteenth Civil War thing, we had a guy show up dressed as a Confederate general on a white horse. We told him the same thing. You need to come to church. He says, well, I don't get a chance to take my horses out very often, but I always have my service dog with me. I asked him, so come on. So over the years, he's shown up a couple times, rides his horse, ties up his horse, comes back in here with his service dog, sits in the back, and joins us in service. So that's the way we are supposed to be about people, not trying to get them to observe certain kinds of rules. Because the Holy Spirit is involved in these decisions, and the rules are useful, but we have to let the Holy Spirit guide the church. These rules, listen, they weren't given for the purpose of saving, but for the believer's welfare. By doing these things, the believers would do well. And there were glorious results. Look at what happened after all this. So they went off, and they went down to Antioch with the message. And pick up where I am here. So when they were sent off, they went down to Antioch, and having gathered the congregation together, they delivered the letter. And when they had read it, they rejoiced because of its encouragement. And Judas and Silas, who were themselves prophets, encouraged and strengthened the brothers with many words. Let me stop there. Remember what I said. They didn't just read the letter and get out of town. In 33, and after they had spent some time, they were sent off in peace by the brothers to those who had sent them. But Paul and Barnabas remained in Antioch, teaching and preaching the word of the Lord with many others also. When these four men arrived in Antioch, the whole church was called together. They get this decree on salvation, and after they read it, there's three things that happened. Number one, there was great rejoicing and encouragement over this message. Silas and Judas were encouraging and strengthening the faith of the Antioch believers. They were building up the believers, assuring them of their faith in the Lord Jesus. And a great teaching ministry grew within that church. Paul and Barnabas were busy teaching and preaching, but there were other teachers and preachers that were not idle. And the message they taught was the word of the Lord, not their own theories and their own ideas. You go back and read Paul's letters, every single one from start to finish. He has one message and one message only. I preach Jesus and him crucified. You're saved by grace through faith. Oh yes, he has lots of instructions for how to live the godly life, but he never varies on what it takes to be saved. It's the gospel only. And so the Gentiles had come to Christ. They left the life of darkness to pursue the light. They had been given some misdirection, having been told that if they cleaned up their act and obeyed some of the law, they could be part of the club. Were there a difference between these Jewish Gentiles and believers? Of course. But love finds what is praiseworthy. The evidence of God's work and encourages people. The Gentiles were accepted. They were no longer a separate people. They were not Jews and Gentiles. They were Christians. The disciples continued in that same line, teaching not the discouraging message of law, but the encouraging and strengthening message of a full acceptance by the Father and by the church. So on this Father's Day, we see a good model for love in this passage. Our Heavenly Father loves us. We are now to be rivers of righteousness, not reservoirs. Do you get the imagery there? We're to be rivers of righteousness, not reservoirs. We're not supposed to hold it in. We're supposed to let it flow. We need to encourage and highlight the work of God. We need to embrace and accept the believer in whom God is at work. And like a perfect model of fatherhood, just remember this. Be strong and courageous. This is the words of the Lord. Do not fear or be in dread of them, for it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. Deuteronomy 31:6. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for loving us as the most amazing, loving Father that could ever be. Father, we pray that as we move forward in our spiritual walk, that we can emulate you, we can show love the way you do, that we can be steadfast to the gospel and do everything in our power to spread that. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand and conclude our service today by singing, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
Now, for a happy Father's Day, let's do what fathers like. Let's go eat. May the Lord bless the food and the hands that have prepared it. We ask that you go before God. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. And in this very day, give you strength, give you courage, and give you peace. And all God's children said, amen. Go in peace.